So let's begin by introducing myself and OVH Cloud. I am Horacio González. As Jean-Francois has said, I work at OVH Cloud as DevRel. And as you can listen, I am a Spaniard. I have been living in France for 20 years, but my accent is horrible in French. And now my English accent is a mix of the worst traits of a Spanish and French accent. Sorry for you. So I am also rather involved in the developer community in the Finisterre. So I organize the Fest de Boudemonde, the Finnish Dev community, and I am a Google developer expert in web technologies and Flutter. And OVH Cloud, yeah, we are the biggest European cloud hosting provider. We have over 30 data centers all around the world. We have more than 1.3 million customers. We have a complete catalog of products from public cloud, private cloud, bare metal, web. So please, next time you have an infrastructure to build, an application to deploy, before going to see our friends from the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, look at our site. I think you will find something interesting for you, and I think you will find the prices rather interesting. But I am here to talk about design systems. And today, when I was rereading my slide, I had a big imposter syndrome moment. Hey guys, I am going to talk about design systems, but I am not a designer. I am a developer and I am doing a talk for developers. So I am going to do some generalization, some simplification. Please don't take offense. I am a developer who does a bit of design on the side. I am not trying to be a professional designer, and I try to explain things for other developers. And donc, let me begin with something that I understood recently, some years ago, is that design, it isn't only the look and feel. The look and feel, the components in your web application, the CSS, the beautiful look of your app, it isn't worth anything if it isn't linked to some other things, to the values, to the spirit that you want to use as a brand. It isn't some metaphysical marketing bullshit. It is something real. You have a brand. In your brand, directly or indirectly, you are going to associate values. You are going to associate an ethos, a spirit. And when you design, you should try to be sure that the look and feel and the behavior of your application is in fast with the values you are trying to associate to your brand. I mean, let's do a sample example. Let's say I have a new startup project. I am going to do a site to cook a delicious dinner in 10 minutes. So a site with lot of recipes about using things that you have every day in your kitchen and proposing some wonderful dinners. That's the concept of my brand. So from this concept, I am going to find some design principles. For example, I am trying to do a site to propose a handmade alternative to microwave dishes. So I should try to have a lot of pretty images of the preparation and of the final dish. I am also trying to do something quick, 10 minutes for a dinner. So the site should show that a light site, not overload with things, with a sample, but effective design. So I am also trying to say a site who allows you to do your dishes with things that you have in your kitchen. Okay, so I must be able to add to have some interesting filtering in order to say, hey, today I only have 3 eggs and 4 potatoes. What can I do with that? So when I have a concept, from the concept, I am going to find some design principles and I am going to decline them. I am going to generate from these principles some functional patterns and some perceptual patterns. And with all that, I am going to define the visual language, the visual shared language of my site. Why I am telling all that? Well, because in order to understand design systems, you should understand the basis of why we are building a design system. So, first concept, design principles. You are going to get your brand and define the core values and principles of your brand and how they apply to design. You are going to define the principle, the design principles and design values, some short message. And it must be shared by everybody around the product, by developers, because they are going to need to adapt the application they are coding to these principles, from graphists, because they are going to generate a visual identity from these principles. This is the root of the design process. Some design principles. For example, Pinterest. Pinterest, some years ago, they redone completely their design process. And they began with 3 principles. First, lucid. So it must be really simple, and user should be able to do what he wants to do in Pinterest without having to think a lot about that. Animated. Because it's a site about sharing images, it needs to be colorful, pretty visually responsive, and not boring and unbreakable. Because you don't want somebody to lose their image because they have done a misstep or something like that. It needs to be easy to use, and people don't need to fear that they are losing things if they do the wrong things. These are the 3 core principles of design for Pinterest. You have the address for the whole article where they explain these principles. Or, for example, another site completely different, gov.uk, the site from the teams that code governmental sites in United Kingdom. As the principles are more down to earth. The user needs do less, the same with data. So these are core principles in how they design the applications. Are developers who are going to code and to define the application must follow them, and graphists who are going to give the look and feel of this application must follow them. They must share these principles. When you have your principles, you can begin to work in your functional patterns, the behavior, the navigation of your site, the kind of user experience you are trying to build, the building blocks of the user interface. The idea is, when you build these building blocks, you are defining the kind of interaction that the user is going to have with your application. You can facilitate some kind of behaviors, making more difficult others. All the choices you do when you are creating these functional patterns are going to define how the user can interact with your application. For example, this is the functional pattern from a site, you know, Netflix. You arrive, you have first pattern, you have always some new film, movie or TV series that is that has the spotlight, and then you have some list, vertical list, from the most important one, the first one, my list, to the all others by subject, by, hey, according you have seen, you will be interested by the series they are trying to promote. So they have a very clear pattern with spotlights and list. And in every list, you have the different elements. It's a pattern that make people to discover things that most of times they wouldn't discover if it was another kind of interface. So it's a pattern in order to make easy to discover new content. Functional patterns, there is also perceptual patterns, the visual elements, the look, things like the typography, the colors, the style of illustrations, the layout, the shapes, the texture, all the visual components. And then the idea is you should try to use these perceptual patterns to express your brand image. For example, if I say Spotify, all of you associate that to the black and green interface, really rather minimalist but pretty, that is a bit cozy, you want to remain there. If I talk about TED Talks, for example, hey, there is really sample, putting the content at the center, lot of white space. What about Medium? Hey, it's like a blog, but with the sample stem of any blog, because they want you to concentrate in the content. All that are associated to the message that the brand want to express. For TED Talk, the important thing is the content, the talk, because it's every talk in TED Talk is a great talk. For Medium, they want something, or the theme and the colors don't make you your attention go away from the central part. They are creating and proposing content. So, example, Slack. Everybody is used now to this kind of perceptual pattern with all the messages, not lots of white space, rather sample, but with the icons, with the menu in a very different color. You see that, and without thinking, you say Slack. That's the kind of brand recognition that you are looking to have with the perceptual patterns. And then the shared language. The product teams, developers, graphists, product owner, product managers need to share the same language. They to have the same patterns. So for this kind of things, we are going to do this pattern. For, hey, we have a new page. Okay, typography. Hey, it is clear, it's this one. Color palette, this one. A navigation pattern, this one. Why? Because you have a whole set of perceptual and functional patterns, you have your principles, and you have built a language, a visual language around that. Okay, that's rather, give me some example. For example, FutureLearn, a set of e-learning. They have some specific components and they wanted to create a shared language. They could have called them a small button, a big button, but they decided to call them medium button and boss button. Simply that make the shared language easier to remember, more fun, so your brain registers it even better, and it has some effects even in the code. You have the button minion and the button boss. So everybody knows that when they are talking about the minion button is the small one and the boss button is the big one. So, I am here to talk about the sign systems, they said. Yes, let's try. What are the sign systems and why you, as a developer, should look at them? Well, in fact, there are many things, and myself, I was rather confused some time ago about that. You have style guides, you have component catalogs, you have design systems. All that is more or less the same thing, not? Yeah, not. The style guide defines the application look and feel. Hey, that's a shitty definition, guy. Yeah, I agree. Let's try this one. The style guide is a document that lists all the patterns, all the principles we have talked about, this shared language, all the styles, and it lists all that with some use case. Hey, if you want to do that, you do it like that. And it defines a design standard. It's a document, a book, a PDF document, a website, and you have that all the question. If you want to do a new page, hey, you are going to look at the style guide, and according to what you are trying to build, you will have, hey, you should use this pattern and this kind of component, and you should use these colors. Okay, good. That's a style guide. For example, if you want a good example of a style guide, rather minimalist because it is their philosophy, you can go to see Uber style guide in brand.uber.com. They define everything from the global visual hierarchy to the colors, the layout, the composition, what illustration style they are looking for, the principles in order to create new icons, new illustrations. Everything is detailed there. Or Medium, for example. Medium, they have a smaller design guide, but rather complete. It defines everything from the typography to the color palette to the icons to the philosophy of having lots of empty space and making your site look at the content, the important thing. So you have also the address if you want to have all the information on the style guide or Medium. Style guides are very, very important. But if you only have a style guide, you are going to find some difficult moments because every time you need to create something new, you are going to read the guide and interpret it. You are going, so they are trying to say me that I should use this kind of pattern, but how I do it? But in the other page, it told me that in order to do this navigation, I need this other pattern. How I mix the two patterns in the same page? You are going to have some difficult moments. So it isn't enough. But they are needed. Component catalog. That's more directly interesting for developers, or at least most developers know better the component catalog than the style guide. It's a repository of components with one or several implementations. So you maybe have your component catalog with one canonical HTML, CSS implementation, or maybe you are lucky you have a React, Angular, and Vue implementations. You have also code examples and all the technical documentation you need in order to build things with this component catalog or component library. The best known one is Bootstrap. It was the first complete and usable component catalog, and it's still a very popular one. It's rather simple, but it's rather complete, and it has a very distinctive bland style. The idea behind Bootstrap was to make a user interface that aren't ugly. They didn't want to do it pretty. They did want to do it not ugly. So it's the perfect component catalog for people who don't like to think a lot about the look and feel of the component. And it works. It's really popular because it works. Another one, more recent, is Lion from ING. Why a banking company is doing a component catalog? Well, because they have their internal design system, a complete one. I will talk about that later. But they are using basic bricks, and they wanted the basic bricks to be as generic as possible. So they have built a complete component catalog from the smallest form item to date pickers to more complex elements. And it is known in web components. I will talk about that later, but it's rather complex. And if you look at the screen cap, they are using a small tooling. I will talk again about it later, a storybook. The idea is a very simple to use tooling that allows you to document and create demos of your component and generate a site like this one, listing all your catalog. And for each element of the catalog, you have the demo, you have the technical documentation, you have some code samples, you have everything you need to create a catalog. So if you have several components, you take a storybook and you transform your isolated components in a world catalog library of components. But if you only have a component catalog without a style guide, you are going to create inconsistency, because I tell you, hey, you are going to do a new page and we need to have a navigation item, we are going to have a form, and we are going to have some buttons. Okay, you can find the form, the buttons, and the navigation widget in your catalog, but you can put it in the page in very different way. So two different developers are going to generate two different pages without any consistency between them. It's the same thing if you have a bag of Lego bricks and you gave them to some children, build something with that, and you too build a dinosaur. I am sure the two dinosaurs will be completely different. Well, so component catalog alone, creating consistency. Style guides alone are ambiguous. Well, maybe we should try to combine both of them, and that's a design system. The official definition should be it's a common visual language for product teams, but a better one for me is a set of design standards, documentation, and principles, a style guide, and the toolkit with the user interface patterns and the components, the component catalog. And when you put that together, you are creating a system, something that allows you to produce from the same input, the same output, create coherency, and make that all your application, all the pages in your application follow the same design standard based on the same principles. You create a coherent user experience. Yeah, design system is more or less, and please, if you are a designer, don't kill me, but it's more or less a style guide and a component catalog. One example, Carbon Design System is one of the few open source design systems. It's done by people at IBM. It's rather complete with a lot of with all the style guide part and the component catalog, a complete component catalog from a small component to rather complex one. a very well-written style guide with lot of examples for the different application pattern, what design pattern you should use. And it's open source, so you can create your own declination of the Carbon Design System and adapt them to the needs of your company. It's really well done. But personally, there are others that I find really interesting. For example, Firefox Photon Design System. As you maybe know, 1 or 2 years ago, Firefox decided to update all the user interface, and they decided to create a design system called Photon in order to have a coherent experience across devices and for all the functionality of a browser. A browser today is one of the most complex applications in the world, and there are a lot of different use patterns, and they wanted to have some coherent design patterns, so in coherent look and feel, some current user experience. So the Firefox Photon is less generic than the Carbon one, but it is really interesting as an exercise. And of course, material design. It is the design system that most developers know, all the Android developers, for example, many web developers. It's a complete one that was released by Google some years ago as the official design system for Android and for their web application. It was really rather innovative at their time, and it is still a very good system. It evolves, and you can see that also as a exercise of evolving, ever-evolving design system. I like it a lot. I am fan of this kind of look and feel and on the minimalist principles behind material design. So, but you are developers, and we are here talking about the part that is directly the most important to you, the component catalog. And sadly, in design systems today, they are still the poor relative, the often forgotten part of the design system. Why? Because most design systems are done by designers, not by multidisciplinary teams with developers. So things are defined, and they give to developers to do one canonical implementation, but there is almost an afterthought. So let's use a sample example, Bootstrap. It was the first component catalog, and it's still at the base of many design systems, because if you are creating a design system and you can take Bootstrap as base for your component catalog, making all the changes in the theme, color, and all that, you will have a component catalog without too much effort. So Bootstrap is a good example. At the beginning, Bootstrap defined all the components using HTML, CSS, and some jQuery. All the components, at the time, most web developers used jQuery in their application, so it was rather easy to use Bootstrap components in your application, no problem. It was by that it was so popular. But by 2011, 2012, AngularJS arrived, and it was AngularJS time. Almost 40 and almost 80% of developers switched to Angular, and in Angular you couldn't use jQuery. You could do it, but it was a bad idea. So, okay, in order to use Bootstrap in AngularJS, they needed to create a new component catalog, UI Bootstrap. It was an implementation of Bootstrap principles in Angular, a new reference implementation. Okay, so many developers began to use it. Most AngularJS developers have used UI Bootstrap at a moment or another. It was really well done. It was nice. And then, as you know, Google decided, hey guys, we are going to do a new version of AngularJS. It's going to be the same, but different. We are going to change the name. It's going to be simply Angular. Hey, no big deal. We are going to switch the language. It's going to be built in TypeScript. And we are going to change the core principles. You won't have directives anymore. You are going to have components. They are like directives, but completely different. And all the nice code that you have written, yeah, you are going to put it in the trash bin. But it's almost the same thing, guys. And many developers had to do just that, put their code in the trash bin. For UI Bootstrap using people, it means that the catalogs were useless. If you have built your design system using UI Bootstrap as base brick, but your new design system wasn't working with the new iteration of Angular technology. Bad. But don't worry, the community is powerful and they decided to do a new implementation of Bootstrap, this time for Angular. It's called ng-bootstrap, and it's the same thing that UI Bootstrap, but in Angular. It's the same thing that normal Bootstrap, but for Angular. It's the third implementation of Bootstrap. And it works. It's really nice. You have all the Angular components corresponding to the Bootstrap components. So your catalog can be more or less the standard if you are basing it on Bootstrap components. Yeah. No, not really, because 8 years ago, Angular was the king of the market. Now, Angular is only one framework between other frameworks. 20-30% if you are lucky. So you have React, you have Vue, you have Preact, you have lots and lots of things, and they change every 2 weeks. For example, now they told me that the big thing is React. Hey, but I have my design system based on Bootstrap, and my people is using React. What can I do? Okay, the community to the rescue. They created React Bootstrap, the fourth implementation of Bootstrap, this time as React components. Hey, it works. Okay, great. But the new kid in the block, that Vue thing, don't worry, you are doing Vue. You have Bootstrap Vue. Yet another implementation of Bootstrap. Five? Yeah, I think so. That's the problem. If you are going to create a design system and you want it to be used in all your application, you have two choices. First one, you say everybody in my company and everybody and all my partners are going to use this technology, React. So I am doing my component catalog on React, or you are going to have something like that, lot of implementation of your catalog. And that is a big problem, because when you have that, you need to maintain all this implementation if you want to design systems to be still alive. So most design systems hadn't the budget to do that. They do a choice. Either they choose one canonical implementation, or they say, we are going to try to ship and maintain 2, 3, 4 implementations, and we are going to have some help for the community, let's hope. And both choices are problematic. If they are shipping only one implementation, well, you can say today in June 2020, All the application in my company and all my partner's application are going to be done in React. And maybe for a few months, it's going to work. But you know the framework market. New things appear, things disappear, new incompatible versions arrive. Are you sure, but really sure, that in 2 years you will be still coding in React? Are you sure as risking having to recode almost everything in 2 years? I am not. And the other choice, having several implementations, is almost worse. You have 2 or 3 implementations. Let's say you have Angular, React, and Vue. You need to maintain them because if you left one implementation without evolving, you are going to have problems. So you need to have teams that maintain all the 2, 3 implementations. And even there, you are going to find cases where people are using another framework, a new one, something incompatible, and you are going to still miss things. Okay, but you could say, if people don't want to use my React and they want to use Angular, hey, they can code the components themselves. We have a style guide, we have a reference implementation, they could do it. Well, yeah, in theory. But people are going to recode, try to follow your style guide, try to imitate your canonical implementation, but it isn't their main job. Their job is to create application. So they are going to rush it, and you are going to have something that is almost sure that it won't be coherent. The coherence is not guaranteed because they are not creating a implementation. They are creating the components they need for their application. Their job, it isn't to create the implementation, it's to write an app. So it isn't going to work. And you are going to have, for different apps, things that aren't coherent, and a user experience that will be far worse than they could be. Example, Carbon Design System, as I told you, they ship 4 implementation. A standard one, plain HTML, CSS without any JavaScript, and then some rich component implementation on Angular, React, and Vue. Hey, but they are ABM. They are able to maintain 3 different implementations on their design system. I am not sure all the companies are able to do that. For example, Google on Material Design, they maintain an Android web, a Flutter implementation. They aren't completely at the same level at the same time, all 3 of them. And we are talking of Google. So most companies aren't able to do that. And even there, if I want to do it not in React, but in Preact or in Svelte or in something different, hey, I have a problem. So for me, the answer to all that are the web components. Now, if we were at a physical meetup, I will ask, how many people here know web components? And let's say half of the room would say me, and they will ask, how many people here has code anything with web components? And maybe 1/4 or 1/3 of the room would say, would lift their hands. As I have not that, I am going to try to resume web components in 3 minutes. It's a challenge. So web components are a standard, a W3C standard, a web standard. That means that they are in your browser as any other standard. They aren't, you don't need any library, anything to use them. You have a recent browser, it's Chrome, Firefox, Safari, you have the world web component standard. And if you are unlucky and you have a very old and outdated browser, you have a, a small polyfill that will allow you to use web components as if you were in a recent browser. And these standards allows you to create your own HTML tags. You are going to say, I am not using a button, I am creating a fancy button with some nice looks and some custom behavior. And you are going to encapsulate the look and the behavior in your new HTML tag, your new web component. They are fully interoperable. It means that they are standard. So once you have declared them for your application, your framework, your web page, they are as standard as the button or the div tag. Your fancy button, it will be as standard for your framework as the normal button. They are based in three pillars: custom elements, shadow DOM, and templates. Custom elements is the part of the standard that allows you to define your tag. Hey, I am defining a new custom element with a tag called my dash element, and the behavior, it is done in the HTML class. And then you can use it as you would use a normal tag. Shadow DOM allows to encapsulate the look. It allows to create a frontier for the style, so you can style your component with CSS, and the CSS you declare inside it, it isn't going to bleed out to the outside. It's going to be encapsulating your component. And the template is the part where you are going to define the look of your component. Okay, three pillars, but in fact, custom elements, web components are like normal HTML components. They have attributes and properties, and you are going to set these attributes and or properties. An input, they have methods, and in order to send information to the outside, you are going to use events. Using the plain old standard web way to change information. That's the force of web components. All applications, all frameworks know how to deal with HTML elements. So all frameworks know how to deal with web components. And as they are a standard, they work everywhere. That site is really interesting, custom elements everywhere. They show, and they have some nice examples, how your web component work in Angular, AngularJS, React, Preact, Vue, Svelte, and all your new fancy framework. So you can be sure that you can use web components without any problem. And you can also use them if you are only plain all static web pages, because when you declare your components, they are standard. You need no framework to use them. So, as I told before, you remember the sad moment when you had to put all your code in the trash bin? Yeah. You have known also the pain to switch frameworks? Hey, last year, all my applications were done in React, and now our CTO wants to do it in Vue. So that means we are going to recode everything. Yeah, you are going to rewrite once again the same code. And what about the companies or the consulting companies where you have customers using different frameworks? You are going to do 3-4 times the same work because one customer uses React, other Angular, other Vue. That kind of problems are real one, and I bet that most of you have already met this problem. Well, the idea is with web components, you can change that. If you code your components following the standard, you will be able to use them in your Angular application, your Vue application, your React application, or without any framework, or in any new framework that will arrive, because they are standard. They are really standard, and they are everywhere. That means that they are even in the space. Do you know SpaceX? You have seen the Dragon rocket go away several weeks ago? Do you know that the user interface of the Dragon is a web application? Hey, you can be proud. The technology you use, it's the technology to put people in the moon. But what you maybe don't know, that the user interface, it's a full standard one. It is done with web components. So yeah, the web components that some people say, hey, they are never going to work, they are in the space. The most complicated technological, one of the most complicated technological projects in the last tens of years has chosen the standard for the user interface. So for me, it was the great news of the last weeks. So web components and design systems. For me, web components, they are the answer of many of the problems we have with the component catalog part of the design systems. Because what we want is our component catalog to be usable in for any developer in our team, in our partner team, in our integration team. I don't want to think about, hey, next year we are changing from Vue to React, so I need to prepare now my reference implementation. These are the kind of problems you don't want to have, especially if you are working with outside developers or you are doing consulting or you have in a big company with a lot of different projects. You want to give in your design system a reference implementation that people can directly use in any and every case. The only way to do that is to use something standard. React components are great, Angular ones, two Vue components are nice, but you cannot use your Vue components in other technology. With web components, you can. So if you choose web component for your implementation of the component catalog of your design system, you can be sure that your component catalog will still be pertinent in 1 year, in 2 years, and you will be able to make it evolve in an independent way of the technology that your company is using to create application. So for me, that's the only real way to future-proof a design system today, using the standard. And it is not only me. As I told you before, ENG, they are the online banking, they are using web component as base for the design system just for this reason. Why SpaceX is doing the user interface in web component? The same reason. The idea is you are creating things that you want to be able to use in any possible context. Maybe today you want to do your application in Angular. Maybe tomorrow you will do in React. It doesn't matter. Your design system, your component catalog, all the instruction, all the code, all the documentation is done following one standard. You document everything with a storybook, for example. And any developer who arrives for a new project only can take the component and drop them in the application. The application will do all the fancy things, the navigation, the menu, the breadcrumbs, everything you want in your application, but the components, the smart part of the application will be reusable and will be agnostic of the technology you are using. And one more thing, because I have almost done 1 hour, time flies. One more thing. Stencil, web components, because I was going to talk about Stencil, I haven't time to do that. So Stencil, web components in general, web components for the design system, it isn't the important part of my talk. The important part is that web components are a standard. They are native to the web platform. That means that they work and they will continue to work in the same way that today we can still use the same HTML tag that 20 years ago and the same CSS. We have more possibility, but the same one works because they are standard. So I know you love your framework. Everybody loves their framework. It's nice, you have spent a lot of time together, you have built nice things together, and you think you are going to continue to do your Angular or your React for years and years. It's nice, love. But are you sure that you love them to the point to marry your framework, like until death? Are you sure you are going to say, I am going to work with this framework for the next 20 years? I am not sure. And if you aren't sure, have you thought about the divorce? Have you thought about the day or you are going to say to your Angular, hey dear, it isn't you, it's me. I need to test a new framework and this cute React is really nice. I am going to spend some time with them. And what about the children? All those children projects you have done with your framework, you are going to maintain them for years too, or you are going to drop them and forget you have done them? That's a problem. And that's a real problem that most web developers has already lived once or twice. So for me, for your design systems, for your application, for all the code you would like to reuse maybe in 1 year, in 2 years, don't do it in your framework, do it as web components. You are making all your code future-proof and you are making the life of your future self way easier. You have a lot of possibilities in order to do web components today, a lot of different libraries with different syntax. Choose one, choose two, choose three. Doesn't matter, they are interoperable, and build your component catalog with them. And then maybe in 2-3 years, when we will meet again, I am sure you will want to pay me a beer or two, because you will see that I was right. And it's a true story. I have already got several beers and a nice meal in a nice restaurant with this prophecy, because it works. One last news. Today you can do web components with Angular. It's a bit more complicated, but it can be done and it's better and better every day, and same thing with Vue. So if you are doing Angular, if you are doing Vue, try to export your components as web components and then you will have the best of both worlds. And for your next application, for your component catalog, for your full design system, please think about your future self, use web components. And I think that's all. Thank you very, very much. I hope you liked it. You have any questions? Oh, I see some questions. I am going to try to answer them. I have a problem with my mouse. Sorry about that. So, about web components, did you recommend any good practice about custom properties or part to override your components? Custom properties of CSS or about, because you are doing the part? Well, there are many good practices about web components. If we are talking about CSS there, I think that for me, it is changing rather fast. You are going to have the possibility of doing a lot of fine tuning in the Shadow DOM and using CSS parts and lots of nice things that are coming. For the moment, I would suggest to do things sample, keeping it sample. And when all the browsers will get the next iteration of the standard with all the fancy parts, you will be able to do it in a more detailed way. But for the moment, if you begin to push the part bar and you begin to push the different terminals CSS, you are going to get things that don't work all around. So for me, that defeats the idea of web components. How easy is to customize CSS theming using web components? Rather easy. Because of Shadow DOM, you are going to define in the Shadow DOM the by default look and the properties you don't want to be able to be modified from the outside. And then you can define the properties you want to be able to be themed. The main color, the background color, the borders. And when you apply the global CSS, you will be able to push a theme to all your components, and you will be able to set the properties that you have defined as tunable. As I told before, things are evolving. It's going to be far more simple. And also, there is a part of the web component community that dislike Shadow DOM, and they use normal DOM. It makes things even easier to theme and to customize the look of the web components. But even in the standard way, using Shadow DOM and custom properties, things can be done rather well now. Did you try web components with things like WASM? Of course. Last year at the first Nant, I did a lab on WASM. I have done it. And I did the lab with WASM just because I needed some functionalities that were difficult to get in pure JavaScript. But WASM today is really ugly to instantiate. You need to create some custom JavaScript part in order to call the WASM module, instantiate it, initialize the object that are going to be shared. That part, that boilerplate, is rather ugly and time-consuming. So for my lab and what I do myself when I need to use WASM is I put my WASM module inside a custom element, inside a web component. Like that, anybody can use my WASM module without even knowing that it is WebAssembly. They have a standard component, they put it in their application, and my components, all the boilerplate in order to instantiate WebAssembly. What is your favorite web component library? Of course, LitElement. I have been doing Polymer since the first day. I was one of the first beta users of Polymer. It was really nice. And with LitElement, they have taken the good parts of Polymer, and they have used all the capabilities of modern browser and modern standard. It is light, it is fast, it is really fun to code. So I really, really love LitElement. Did you recommend to write web components with vanilla JavaScript or using things like LitElement? Well, personally, I love LitElement because it makes things easy, fun, and I really love the coding style of LitElement. It is only syntactic sugar. You can do the same thing with plain old JavaScript, but you are going to do all the boilerplate by yourself. And as LitElement is very well optimized, the size different is rather small. So for me, it's better to use directly a light helper like LitElement or Stencil than doing the vanilla one. I know that some people in the community prefer to keep things vanilla. For me, it's too much work for nothing. I am going to try. For a new project, would you recommend to use web components for all presentational components in order to be resilient to any potential framework migration? Maybe not all the presentational, or maybe I don't fully understand what you mean by presentational. I would suggest to use web components for all the components that are important for application, all the business component, not for a menu, not for a navigation bar, but for example, for all the documents, presenting code, presenting data, presenting your data, all the components where user interact with your application, for all the things that are in boilerplate and structure. If you do the skeleton with your React, Angular, Preact, and you do the business with the component, when you want to reuse the components in another framework, hey, it will be rather really easy, because when you are using a new framework, the skeleton you are going to need to code it in the new framework. It is really linked to the framework. So, but the business part, I take my component from the Angular application and I drop it in the React application. Is there any web comp? Sorry about that. I tried to get to the app. Is there any web component library you recommend to a React developer? Yes, Stencil. Stencil, it isn't really a library. I have done, Ilya, 2 weeks, a webinar about Stencil for CodeMotion. I will send you the link if you want, and I have done another in Stockholm that is also on YouTube. But the idea is Stencil is a web component compiler. You are going to write your web component in a rather similar way to React, using GS6, for example, using a reactive mode. Most React developers are able to code their Stencil components after 1 hour, and then it compiles them into pure vanilla JavaScript web components. So it's very, very efficient, very performant, and I really love Stencil. For a React developer, for me, it's a no-brainer. It's the best solution. For an Angular developer, I would say Lit Element. I would say it's the good compromise. You are going to find things similar, and you are going to make a lot of things way easier, and it is really easy to learn. Are web components working with things like web workers? Hey, your web components are normal components. Are done with HTML, CSS. Are they behavior? Are done with JavaScript. So it works with any standard technology. I know that some people are using web workers in order, for example, to externalize some loads from the main thread and using the web workers to execute them. And you can do the same thing with web components. It's the same thing as before at WebAssembly, I told. It's the big advantage of the standard. You have your web components, you can use the web workers, you can use WebAssembly, you can use all the native APIs of your browser, and it simply works. What about compatibility with old browsers? Old browsers, yeah, really old browsers, like Internet Explorer 8, because it is the only one that really have some problems. Well, there is a polyfill, and many things will work, I say many, in Internet Explorer 8. But some things they aren't going to work well, and it's going to be really, really, really slow. But if you are using Internet Explorer 8 today, almost all the technologies you can use are going to have the same problem. Angular, it uses the web components polyfill inside, so you're going to have the same problem. Maybe Svelte that will try to compile everything in plain old JavaScript, but then you will still have an old version of JavaScript. So with some transpilers, well, if you are using Internet Explorer 8 or something like that, I am really sorry, and I think most things won't work today. Sorry about that. Is there any use case where you want to create web component without Shadow DOM? Yes. For example, last year I did a web component in order to do the DOM tree inspector, the same thing you have in Chrome when you have the developer tools and you see the inspector and you have the whole DOM tree. There is an implementation of the DOM tree in React. There is the implementation using internally in Chrome, in implementation for Firefox, but I wanted to use that for one application to doing some database querying. And I wasn't using React, so I coded myself in web components. And then the idea of a DOM tree explorer is you have many, many levels of recursion. The node has a node who has another node, another, another, another. If for each one of this node you are adding a shadow DOM, you are creating layer over layer of shadow DOM for nothing, because you want the whole tree to have the same look. So all the children components I coded then without shadow DOM in light DOM. And then I only use the shadow DOM in the global one. So inside the global component, everything was light DOM, and I multiplied the performance by 50 because I was using really big DOM tree. And then with, if you are doing that, if you can take out some layers, performance is wonderful. Do you think it's a good practice to use web components to only do functional things like fetching data? Good question. If you ask to myself 3 years ago, I will say, yes, of course, it's really important because you are going to encapsulate all data and you are going to have a whole declarative paradigm, or all your components are declarative and not imperative. It's good architecture. Well, today, the ecosystem has evolved a lot. You have JavaScript modules, you have things that are way more organized. So today, for me, you use web components for all the components who has a visual part, and you use plain old JavaScript modules for all the part like fetching data or things like that. What about code size delivered to client? Isn't many duplicated code like CSS if you provide a web component? Well, not for example, if you are doing LitElement, for example, and you can do the same thing with vanilla web component, but if you are doing LitElement, the CSS part is a static. It's a static variable, so you are going to have only one for all the instance of your component. Yeah, in the DOM part, you are going to have the shadow DOM with the components, and that it isn't fully true. It is evolving with all the new standard for CSS. So yeah, for some edge cases like the DOM tree I talked before. Yeah, it's better to use only light DOM and not having the CSS in the shadow DOM. But for the most usual part, it isn't a problem. What are the next step feature for web components? Whew. Okay, it's a good question. There is all the shadow DOM evolution. And for me, it's going to be the big part, the biggest evolution to come. Beside that, I am not sure really the biggest one for the coming months. I am going to think about that. And you ask me the question by Twitter, I will try to give you a more detailed list. Do you continue to work with Flutter? Yeah, I continue to work with Flutter. For me, Flutter and web development are complementary. The idea is, today most people don't use application in their phone, in their tablet. Okay, let me rephrase that. They use application only for the things that are important to them. If I ask you, any of you, what application you have in your smartphone, I am sure you have your favorite social network, your Instagram, your Twitter, your email, maybe some application for work. But when you are in Twitter and you see a link to a news in a newspaper, and the newspaper tell, hey, can you install the Le Monde application? I am sure that most of you, like 90% of people, say not, I want to do it in web. Why? Because you don't want to load your phone with lot of useless application that you are going to do only to use only once or twice a year. So if you are doing things for mobile, I suggest you to ask yourself if your application is going to be for the first type, something important to the user that they are going to want to have it installed, or mostly because for marketing reasons, you need to be present in the store, like the Le Monde application. Almost nobody uses it. It is outdated, but a big journal like Le Monde needs to be in the store. If you are from the first class, hey, Flutter is wonderful. It's going to make you super nice user experience. So for an application that is important, dear to your customers, I would suggest Flutter. And you are going to do the same application for Android and iOS with the same tool. It's almost too good to be true. And if you are doing for the big quantity of useless application that need to be done for marketing reasons, then you do a web application, a progressive web app, and use things like capacitor in order to put it in the store. It's going to add half an hour to your development time, and you are going to have your web application available in the store, and everybody will be happy. So the web workers, what the import path? The import in web components, like the imports in general in browser, is one of the parts that can make a bit tricky, or could be a bit tricky. Now they have an import object when you can get the real path for every one of your files. It works already in Chrome, Firefox, and Safari, I think, since the last one. So you have an API call in order to get the full path of any module, and you can use real path and not relative one. So for me, all the importing part, it was a big problem, but not only for web workers, for things like importing a static configuration files from inside a web component and using the import API call, you have a nice way to get the real address. Flutter web, okay. What can I say about that? It works. And if you are doing a nice application and you need to have quickly a web implementation, it can be done. But the web part, it isn't as well done as if you code a nice web application. It works, but it isn't still as good as in real web. In the same way that if you are doing a web application and user capacitor are putting it in the store, and you have a real Flutter application in the site, Flutter application is going to be better. But for web, it is the opposite. You have your Flutter web and you have the real web application. In general, the real web application will be lighter, better, and easier to debug. For the moment, I trust the Flutter team in order to make it better and better, and maybe next year, I will give you a completely different answer. Wow, I am really, really happy. I had never had so many questions after a talk. Thank you very, very much. I hope you liked it. So if you have other questions, please don't hesitate to ask. And if not, Jean-Francois, you can take control of the room.
Okay, thank you, Horacio. So if you are too shy to ask questions to Horacio now, we will continue a little bit with the table. Don't forget that when you are on the table, you can only chat and talk with people in the same room. So you are not broadcasting to the whole audience. So see you everyone in the table, and thank you again, Horacio.
Thank you very much. I am going to be in the table too for a moment. So if you want to ask any question, we can speak now. Thank you again.